Good morning and welcome to Rich Thoughts for Breakfast.
I'm Harold Herring, and that's my fine wife, Beth. On today's call, we're going to discuss seven ways to recognize a God idea. You see, there are good ideas and God ideas. The question is, how can you tell the difference? Here are seven ways to recognize a God idea. First, pray. If you feel peace, it's His idea. The key to developing a peace factor in your life is to know the Word and pray it. If you don't have confidence in the Word of God, you'll never have peace. Why worry about situations when you can pray the Word and give it all to God? Let Him deal with it. Praying with confidence in the Word is the antibiotic for the disease of a worried mind. As we've said for years, if you worry about situations, it means you don't trust God. Gain strength, comfort, and yes, peace with John 14:27, 14:27 Classic Amplified Bible. Peace I leave with you, my own peace I now give and bequeath to you. Not as the world gives do I give you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, nor let them be afraid. Stop allowing yourselves to be agitated and disturbed. And do not permit yourselves to be fearful, intimidated, cowardly, and unsettled. Notice that last sentence in the verse. It's the bottom line of how you act or react to adversity. Stop allowing yourselves to be agitated and disturbed. And do not permit yourselves to be fearful and intimidated and cowardly and unsettled.
Second, does it line up with the Word of God? God will never give you an idea, a directive, a new thing, or any other word from Him that conflicts with His own Word. It just will not ever happen. How can we be so sure? Well, obviously, the Scripture says so. Mark 3:24, Classic Amplified says, if a kingdom is divided in rebellion against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. God will never lead us to do something that doesn't line up with what He says in His Word. We will never receive an unction from the Holy Spirit that is outside what God's Word has to say. If there's misdirection involved, we can be assured it is not from God. And one more thing we feel stirred to say, it's called our 1-2 punch to know if our ideas line up with the Word. Number one, don't think as the world thinks. Proverbs 4:23, New Century Version says, be careful what you think, because your thoughts run your life. If we want to know if our idea is a God idea, we need to live the words of Romans 12:2, New Living Translation, in part says, let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. That is a daily exercise. And number two, when we think like He thinks, we'll always know if we have a God idea.
Wow, good. Third, is the idea in line with your God-given vision? If you don't have a God-given vision for your future, keep pursuing God until you realize the one He's been trying to give you. God is not hiding His vision from your future, playing some sort of spiritual hide and seek. If you don't have a vision, somewhere you've lost or are ignoring the revelatory insight God is trying to give you. Habakkuk 2:2 clearly came to mind. It's the scripture the Lord gave us for you. And the Lord said, write the vision and make it plain, that he may run that readeth it, for the vision shall speak. It will surely come, it will not tarry. Now, the contemporary English version of Habakkuk 2:2 says it this way. Then the Lord told me, I'll give you my message in the form of a vision. Write it clear enough to read at a glance. Your vision must be written down very clearly. If you're asking yourself what your vision should be, then ask yourself this. What lives passionately in your heart? Whatever you love, God has placed in your heart for a reason. Keep reviewing your vision until you make it clear how precise that God wants it to be.
Fourth, if you are married, are the two of you in agreement? One of the most unwise thing a Christian can do.
Dumbest thing.
Well, you could say it that way too. Is to not be in agreement with their spouse about a God idea.
That's true.
Genesis 2:24 says, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and the two, and they shall be one flesh. Contemporary English version says, that's why a man will leave his own father and mother. He marries a woman and the two of them become like one person. Please notice the scripture says the husband and wife become like one person. If you're one person and you don't agree, it's a spiritual house that's divided against itself. Ephesians 5:31 says, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and the two shall be one flesh. Your one flesh becomes like one person. But this is what is, I think, most clear of all is Amos 3:3, because everybody doesn't always agree about everything 100%, but they can come to an agreement. And in Amos 3:3, New Living Translation, it says, can two people walk together without agreeing on the direction? So the point of it is you do your best to agree on the direction that you are both going, because you are both going, need to be going in that direction. And some people will say, well, you know, Brother Harold, Sister Bev, my spouse is not saved and is not interested in the things of God or achieving the success that he wants for us. This is often an unfortunate and difficult situation, but God can and he will direct you. It's going to take some dedication on your part about what you say and how you say it and how you act, but God will give you a godly response for your situation. He can forgive your mistakes if you got, you know, joined together without, well, him really agreeing. But you know, God will always, and he never forsakes us, and he will always be there for you. So the bottom line is, as much as is possible, you need to get your spouse in agreement with the direction that you are going. Now, if you're single, hallelujah, then you just follow the voice of the Holy Spirit.
Wow. Fifth, God will never tell you to do something that causes confusion. Our Heavenly Father is a God of order. Confusion, well, that's the devil's anointing. Peace encourages where confusion drives. Well, if you feel driven, stop, because the enemy is in your camp. From the first scripture to the last, God brought order out of chaos and confusion. Read the first three verses of Genesis. Where you will find sin, you will find confusion. Read those first three verses. James 3:16. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. Bottom line, God will give you ideas to bring order, but he will never give you an idea to create what he hates, and that's confusion.
Sixth, get confirmation from someone in your inner circle. Who forms your inner circle? Is it just, well, your best friend at work or people in the neighborhood or somebody you grew up with or those you play maybe pickup basketball with or your Pilates group? Or maybe it's just someone you met at church. You need to name the people you consider in your inner circle. There might be 1, 2, 3, who knows, 4, 7. But the qualities of the person in your inner circle, well, they need to be, let me put it this way. What qualities the person to be in your inner circle are they other than familiarity? What does the Word of God say about who your inner circle should be? Jeremiah 23:18 in God's Word translation says, Who is in the Lord's inner circle and sees and hears his word? Who pays attention and listens to his word? That ought to tell us that our inner circle needs to be comprised of people who will listen, pay attention, and they're acting, making active the Word of God in their life. Then you have a group with which you could really share your ideas because you are all on the same page. Let us share like a basic medical fact. Everyone obviously has a brain. Whether they choose to use it or not, sometimes, you know, you think, okay, but we do have one. And every born-again believer has the mind of Christ, according to 1 Corinthians 2:16. I mean, you need to read 1 Corinthians 2:16. It tells you have the mind of Christ. And as a believer, we need to be implementing and asking God to have his mind on every situation that we need to make a decision on. Say, Lord, I need your mind on this decision.
Amen. Seventh, when God gives you an idea, it will not go away. God gave you one of his ideas, not just for you to play with, tell your friends about. Know that God gave you a creative idea for you to do something with. I'm not sure who said this next quote. Truthfully, I wish I had. Nevertheless, it's powerful. Here it is. God gives you spiritual ideas, and in turn, they give you daily supplies. Let me say that again. God gives you spiritual ideas, and in turn, they give you daily supplies. You know, it's up to us to provide daily nourishment for our ideas. We're the ones to whom it will, well, it's going to grow and multiply. How do we provide the nourishment? Well, big surprise. Seven words. Read your Bible. Do what it says. When God gives you an idea, he expects you to do it. God doesn't mind if you ponder, consider, reflect, pray, or meditate, as long as you then get up and do it. And he's not looking for excuses from you or from us or for us to blame someone else as to why we cannot do what he's asked us to do. You can have a God idea, but it also has to be in God's timing.
That is so true.
Or it'll be a failure.
Sometimes it takes that meditation, the pondering, the considering, the reflecting until you find out what it is he wants you to do and how he wants you to do it.
Absolutely.
Because he can, well, fine tune them.
Yeah.
Our ideas, and he will.
In life, timing is critical. If you need to understand God's timing, you need to understand it to fulfill your destiny.
That's right.
It's just that simple. Hallelujah. Go to haroldherring.com. If you're blessed by the teaching and the ministry, click on the button that says sow a seed. Just ask God what seed he'd have you sow. Do what he says. That's all we'll ever ask. And until tomorrow morning at 8:30 Eastern, God bless you. Happy trails.
And keep thinking rich thoughts.
We love you. We appreciate you. God bless you. Bye-bye.